out of the day. God. What's going on?
Oh, no. They hired a quack.
I could have told you not to do that.
We get a lot of shots. Everybody come to the net. We just have to get more and more pucks to the net.
I'm about to listen to Pucks on Net.
We used to talk about in Vancouver getting pucks on net.
Pucks on net.
What were you saying about putting pucks on net?
This is JT Miller with the Vancouver Canucks, and you're listening to Pucks on Net.
Pucks on net and driving and making a hard night on it.
Come to the funnest day in Canucks history.
Well, I'm on tape from my haunted apartment. Nope. My apartment on above the grounds, the old haunted Burger King. My name is Ryan Chapp. I'm going to be your host for the evening.
First show jitters.
Yeah.
Get it out, pal.
Yes, and. We can do this.
Yes, and.
Is Brock Besser the best shot in the NHL?
I can't believe that you bring up Brock Besser this early into the episode.
I'll be your host for the evening. My name is Ryan Chapp. A couple of quick links for you. Patreon.com/pucksonnet. Pledge a couple of bucks. Get immediate access to our video podcast. I don't go to bed until I post it.
He doesn't. He's up so late.
It's just about 7 o'clock right now. Half the show's in the can. Spoiler alert. So I'll be going to bed at a reasonable hour. If you don't want to support the show monetarily because it's Blue Monday, youtube.com/pucksonnet. Go subscribe. Alternate commentary episode live stream coming up this week and video podcast there. To my camera right, Mr. Arash Bamarzadeh. Gita, not on the show this week, but we were texting all day watching the Jimmy Rutherford press conference. Arash, how are you?
I'm doing great, and best of luck to Gita. She's having a surgery upon another surgery, apparently. Stuff went horribly wrong. She was getting a...
There's a Pucks on Net internal investigation.
There's a Pucks on Net internal investigation. We believe there's some malpractice. Stevie, or Ryan's resident dog, might be to blame. She was a bit too good of a girl, let's say. I don't know. What's up? You looking at my
I'm looking at your little windsock there. Yeah. You got to get that on there.
Okay, well, that's not my fault.
There you go.
Thank you. We're not even going to edit that out.
Who prepped this equipment?
Stevie. That dog. She did it again. No, we're doing great. Ryan, so before we hop into things, I'm doing good. Tell the listeners what the episode format's going to be today. It's a little bit different.
Yeah, so things, a little wrench was thrown into us about 9 o'clock in the morning or 10 o'clock. So we're going to be talking Canucks, sauce it or toss it. On Friday, I conducted a very fun interview. There is a new documentary coming to the CBC next Sunday about Harold Ballard entitled Offside. The Harold Ballard story.
I can only think that that is putting it mildly when coming to Harold Ballard.
It's an incredible piece of business. We got an advanced screener last week, and I chatted with executive producer Chuck Tatham on the show. He's I wasn't sure how the interview would go. Canadian guy, lifelong Habs fan. Had a great conversation, and he was also a producer on How I Met Your Mother. Talked about that. Talked about Arrested Development.
Nice.
Fun little conversation.
Pop-up gets a treat. Pop-up gets a treat.
There's always money in the carved sandwich stand.
There's always money in the carved sandwich stand, Francesco.
That's coming off after Sauce It or Toss It, but...
Okay, so a big Canucks-oriented episode today. Lots of things happen, but before we do,
the Seattle Kraken had won 8 in a row, including 7 straight on the road before they lost today versus.
Yeah, they're in year two. they're in year two. Godspeed to them. But Ryan, I feel I would like to take a minute.
Sure.
Or actually, more than a minute.
Okay.
Before we jump into the really fun stuff, can we talk about Gino?
Absolutely.
Can we talk about Gino off the bat? Because I feel like I understand that the Canucks had scheduled this before Gino's passing yesterday. Listen, they don't play until Wednesday. They could have had this exact press conference on Tuesday. Let's take a second. Gino has some memories to me and my family, specifically to my brother and my dad. Yeah, specifically to them, because, you know, I was 5 years old, really, when 94 happened, and I came here in I think I was here 93 or 94 from Iran. I was born here, went back to Iran, came back. I'm going to let you start off.
Okay.
How are your... Tell me your family's connection with Gino, what Gino meant to this market, and the legacy he leaves behind.
He, you know, for those not in the Vancouver market or that's a fan of another team or didn't grow up with the Canucks, he was, you know, he was the enforcer. You don't want to put the G word on a guy like Gino Odjick.
Mm-hmm.
Incredibly close with Pavel Bure to the point he named one of his children after him and just looked out for him his entire career.
Mm-hmm.
He was somebody that was a fan favorite where it's like he was, you know, everybody wanted to wear 29.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he was respected. He was, from all accounts, he was a very fun guy. He was a very gentle guy. You know, everybody seems to have a tale of running into him somewhere around town, and he stayed in Vancouver. He, you know, did a lot of things, for the benefit of the local Indigenous community here. Mm-hmm. And he was just, a very bright light in this town, in this hockey market. And, you know, we grew up watching the Canucks and loving when Gino had to take care of business when somebody was too close to Kirk or too close to Pavel. And yeah, it wasn't just, that's just a knuckle dragging meathead. That was a kind man with a good heart. And he fought for a long time. He had a heart diagnosis in 2014, but you know, who would have thought Gino would keep fighting?
Right.
And
of course.
It was nice. And he was a fixture at Canucks games. And it was really sweet to see the quote from Francesco Aquilini, who mentioned that he was a close friend of his and reached out to him for advice and was just a figure in his life. So I really appreciated that.
Yeah. I think when we look at Gino and his impact in Vancouver in the 90s at the time, you know, the idea that who was the centerman on that line? Is it Ronning? Was it Ronning Bure or was it Lyndon Bure Odjick?
I'm not sure.
Okay. So you guys have to forgive me because I was very young at the time.
When needed, would be playing on Bure's.
Yeah. Name. When needed, that would be happening. You know, it throws back to, you look at the Canucks now. And having someone like Gino on the ice, in that roster, you feel like that's, you know, they need someone who's brimming of soul and has that protector in them.
Yeah.
And protector can be anything from, you know, physicality to spatial awareness. Just to say, like, you know, your band of brothers to actually go into the trenches with
them.
Yeah. You know, I talked to my dad very quickly today in the morning. I was at Costco. And I talked to my dad and I told him about the news. And he told me about this clip that was circulating, the very popular clip that's circulating. He actually referenced it. It's this clip of Gino basically taking on the entire St. Louis Blues. Like, Glenn Anderson's there. He's shirtless. He's going around. The commentator's like, "Hey, Gino needs to be suspended into the next years." What? Okay, I'm doing my Rick Jarnett.
It was over the top. Very similar.
It was over the top. But you saw like this reverence of, okay, well, this is what I have to do, and mm-hmm. that's so great. His impact within the Indigenous community, you know, is one of his most famous quotes. I'm going to paraphrase it. I apologize again, but you know, he's basically saying, you know, I'm just a kid from the res, and if I can do it, anyone can. And so understanding that, you know, within certain BIPOC communities where guys, to make it, it's so hard. And to kind of continue on a legacy like that, if you're Indigenous, if you're brown, whatever, you know, brown, black, whatever person of color in this society, it's so hard to achieve a dream that other people will take for granted. And Gino was the type of person that not only did he achieve his dream, he was, even though he went on to play in Montreal, etc., he maintained being a Canuck. He was a Canuck until you know, the end. And then I really just look back on this week, and to finish up, I really look back on this week because I've been questioning, what does it mean to be a Canuck anymore? To be a fan, to be a player, it's really foreign to me. I don't know. It's been a really, really long time. The bubble was maybe the last time I kind of felt a little bit of, okay, maybe an identity. When we talk about identity, you talk about Gino Odjick.
Yeah.
That is what being a Canuck is. That's what it looks like. That's what it feels like. And I hope that now that we jump off to this, to the more business side of things, that we keep that in mind, that that's the place where we need to get to. It doesn't matter about wins. It doesn't matter about draft picks. It doesn't matter about... You need to get on the ice and present yourself like Gino did when he was wearing a Canucks uniform.
Absolutely. Two things I wanted to touch on before we go into what's happened today.
Yep.
He mentioned in an interview in about 2017, and maybe it was out sooner, that he asked for 29 because that was his father's residential school number.
Amazing.
And he's like, and I feel like that should have been a more bit of a prominent piece of information in this city, mm-hmm, or in this market, but it wasn't, and that's fine. But he's like, yeah, and back then you didn't have a name, you had a number. And I thought that that kicked me right in the heart when I heard that yesterday. Mm. And then, you know, we all love Gino Odjick, and you didn't know the influence he had on Indigenous players in the NHL and in hockey. And Ethan Bear was speaking with him about coming to Vancouver. He was in regular contact and clearly seemed to be influenced by Gino and had a relationship with him, and mm-hmm, scored a goal right after he passed. And he's like, you know what, that's something bigger than hockey. And he said he was crying on the bench or crying after the game. And yeah, some might just assume that he was a tough guy that played here 20 years ago, 20, 30 years ago, but it was a hell of a lot more. And yep, good people leave lasting impacts.
Yeah, it you know, you can be a win. The thing is, like, you can win a goddamn Stanley Cup, and you can be Glenn Anderson. You can be Glenn Anderson. Okay, well, no shade on. Well, okay.
Lots of shade on.
Oh,
him.
A lot of shade on. But yeah, man, like, you ask my father, who is now 75, and that lasting impact of him remembering that incident. I hope we can get back to that. And I hope that we can not only for our franchise, but in the memory of warriors like Gino, that we can just bring this franchise back to where it needs to be. And you know what? Roles that we play as fans, roles that you play in media, it's not just people in the GM's box or the owner or whatever. Like, yeah, great. It's their little toy box, but we, you know, fans and people who follow this team are the legacy, and the players are the legacy.
Yeah.
And everyone else, well, it's their responsibility to come to work. And speaking about coming to work,
Jim Rutherford came to work today. He put his lunch in a bucket, and he knew it was.
The man had a flask, did he not? He had one under the table when those two doctors were talking. I don't believe I posted a photo on my Twitter. Dr. Nick Riviera in there. Just I think we know who screwed up. This was a big day. This press conference. I listened to it twice. Once on my AirPods when I was in Costco, like in again, it was a big Costco day. I went to Costco.
Were you listening live in Costco?
Yeah,
I just picture you where like Jay Janauer starts talking. And it's
dude,
like,
Jay Janauer came.
What do you think of this season? I just imagine you like listening, pushing your cart forward, like knocking over a big display. I'm like, he's going with the season ticket holder quote.
Jay came out with some kind of monster.
he was an untuned snare drum.
So I listened to it twice. The first time, yes, it was in a rushed a little bit of a fury because I was like, I'm not getting the exact answers that I think I want. And
I thought you were talking about the stuff you bought us.
Oh, salt, baby. Salt, vitamins, and dishwasher detergent.
These could be props through the episode.
No, just keep them for yourself. It's okay. We got a bird in the other room. It's true. That's true. Not even a joke. But then, you know what, Ryan? Before we get into the minutiae of everything, I listened to it twice. on the second time, I really believe that the answers that Jim Rutherford was giving were incredibly honest. Yeah. Some of them were answers that you particularly probably didn't want to hear. Like, they were kind of a little bit, you know, not exactly like, hey, yeah, we're going to tear everything down and a 37-year-old Rob Shrimp is going to come and be the first line center for your Canucks and we're going to tank for the next 5 years. Like, okay, it's not to that extreme.
Rob's like older than that.
Is he?
He was like...
2005, he's like 36, 37, 37 probably?
Oh, maybe. I thought he was drafted like 02.
He was my favorite young.
But I bet London he's 41.
Knights, that London Knights team was sick.
Yeah.
So I listened to it twice. And then it was just... There was on one side of the extreme, you're not getting those answers. The other side, you didn't get... He came out and he said, you know, we're not going to trade first-round picks for older players. We're not going to do that. We're going to hopefully accumulate draft capital. And I know there was that report that came out from our favorite really good podcast talking about how they, they're not looking for draft. They haven't asked for draft capital at all. Okay. You know, the one thing I'm getting a little tired of and a little exhausted is the cycle of rumor and innuendo.
Yep.
To be fair, a lot of people haven't broken a lot of Canucks news in a very long time, so I'm going to take stuff with a grain of salt beyond friend of the show, Rick Dollywall.
Yeah.
Friend of the show, Rick. Well, let me tell you. Ooh.
If you've, depending on what you've consumed, what you've read this week, Rick Tockett is hired. He's sitting he's sleeping in the Murphy bed in Rogers Arena, and it's just a matter of time before he's the head coach.
He's literally pulling off the Master Chief, wake me up when you need me at the end of Halo 3. Where my Halo stands at. Okay, so he didn't give those answers. So what he basically came out and said, we're going to go after players that are off their ELCs that need a second chance. And he elaborated on that fact, because that clip alone, I understand you can take it and be really upset because now you're getting flashbacks of like Michael Granlund and Sven Berchi. I totally, absolutely. But here's the thing though, he did, and this is completely truthful, them going out and getting a first round pick that won't come in and step in for 3 or 4 years. And you never know what's going to happen with that player, even if they have a high pedigree. You know, they can get Matvei Michkov. Let's say they get a top five pick. They take Matvei Michkov from the KHL. What if he never comes over?
Yeah.
What if he just, something happens? And so the logic is, if there's another team that has a high draft pick, high caliber player, that for whatever reason, if it's Alexei Lafreniere, if it's somewhat Alex Newhook in Colorado, you look at these players and you say, okay, well, we might be able to go, like the Schrodinger's box with them is open just slightly. It's not fully open. We don't know exactly the player they're going to be forever at 2021. Yeah. So if we can take these players and give them a second chance in a different environment with different minutes, different coaches, whatever, they might rebound. And there's a logical pathway. So that's the thing that illuminated within my mind, is a lot of the answers had logical pathways. Some of the stuff I had problems with, I don't know about you, Ry, was stuff related around the cap. He gave the JT Miller answer where he said, well, you know, the cap's going to go up to 90, 95 million.
When?
So, yeah, I don't know.
Wasn't that supposed to be this year?
Like my parents in the summer of 1996 when Pokemon Red came out on a trip to California, Arash, we're going to Disneyland, until we got to Los Angeles and they told me, sorry, Arash, Disneyland is closed, when Disneyland was actually not closed, but they just ran out of time.
Roller coasters just going on.
But Dad, Bubba, the Mickey is right there. No. You know what? No, my parents at the time, they took me to Los Angeles, and they admitted to me that they didn't have a ton of money. And at the time, you know what? I totally get it, and I'll never bug them.
Yeah.
Because look where I am now, baby. I'm going to Costco. Iran doesn't have a Costco. I mean, maybe they do. What would Iranian Costco be called?
I can't make those jokes.
Guys, he's learning. He's learning. I'm so proud of you. So, yeah, it was, he made the JT Miller thing about the cap, and then came out and said, well, it's not going to be a problem then. And then we immediately all knew, it's like, clip that. Clip that when it does eventually become a problem. But, Rye, let's get your vibes on it.
I loved it. Mm-hmm. You know, you could have an old school kind of antiquated approach to it. Be like, oh, you're sitting there eating a shit sandwich. And be like, yeah, that's what you have to eat when your team is playing as poorly and consistently as the Canucks.
Sorry to interrupt because I'm going to give you the runway. Did you not feel that he actually came out and just was like, guys, everyone knows we got a kind of a shit sandwich here.
Yeah.
He didn't try to come out and say, well, no, that we got a Michelin star sandwich. Someone just pulled the fire alarm.
Guys, it's the damnedest thing. The sprinklers went off and the yeah. I don't know about y'all.
I don't know about y'all.
But I just watched a front office in an organization never give press conferences, never be transparent. We're not saying this one is all that transparent, but they're facing the music. Guys, if this was a year ago, this is 2 years ago.
Right.
Jim and John would have just locked the door to their office.
Oh, my Christ. I can't even think about if this was a year ago.
They would have locked the door to the office. They would have hit under the desk, and they would have waited for the phone to stop ringing.
No, the interview would have been like, you know, I just think it's, like, really unfair that we, like, traded for Oliver Ekman-Larsson. And he's just being a meanie, and he's not playing good. Guys, like, come on, it's like Garland keeps spinning.
But Jim Rutherford, he came out and he's like, oh yeah, we know we're not playing well. We know we're playing awful. We know you know, or we want you to know that right. We know that you know they're bad, and yep. We all want Connor Garland. Let's all put that out there. We all want him.
He's the hottest thing out there right now. Everyone wants Connor Garland. Hopefully this resonated with you as well. But he had a segment where he talked about the fact that this core group of players very rarely, if ever, this season have come together as a team. He explained at the very beginning of the year they had an opening day team dinner. And he said, you know, we have a lot of great players here, but are we a great team? And he brought up the Colorado game where he said, that was a team. That's what a team can do. Ryan, because I agree with that, do you share the sentiment that this is also like that he was completely on the nose, and that answer was exactly what fans are seeing.
Mm-hmm.
And it's so refreshing that this organization, a member of this organization, comes out and says exactly the same thing that a fan would be feeling and seeing at when they're watching a Canucks game. And that was like, oh, okay, I don't think I'm being gaslit on this one. Okay, yeah. Fantastic.
Yeah, and it was, he was telling us what we all knew, and we wanted to know. We wanted them to know. We want all to be on the same page, and we are all on the same page.
Right.
The Canucks are not a cohesive unit. They are.
They are a group of players.
Six clumps of players that kind of do things together occasionally, and that's why they, you know, extra attackers, power plays. They just don't seem cohesive. They've never really gelled together, and it's all of these players on this team could play very well elsewhere with other players,
right.
Or you know. But it's like in this group, you don't see it. You see a lot of individual efforts, or you see a good bit of chemistry with two players, and then stashed with another guy that just doesn't work, or you just have a Garland dries anybody third line,
right.
But that's more of a literal sense. It's never felt like the team has been won, and you know, and fans and media will come up with those, you know, these beefs here or this feud here or this click here, and yeah, it's never felt cohesive.
I have a question for you. If let's take it back to when they took over the team, you had the Boudreau bump.
Mm-hmm.
coming out of the Boudreau bump, knowing that they thought, okay, in the interview, he said, you know, at the time, who asked the question? It might have been Drance or, oh, shoot, can't remember off the top of my head, came out and said, we might, well, you know, I thought that we needed minor surgery, and now we need major surgery. Taking it back, they have the Boudreau bump. They're playing the way that they did. In the off season, they add around the margins. They get Mikheyev. They get Kuzmenko. They sign Miller to the extension. Then this season happens. And I think that the moves that they made in the off season do fit with the idea that they had that, oh, this was a minor surgery thing that perhaps, you know, in their minds, they said, yeah, we can get off Myers probably. Yeah, we can move some money around. Turned out it was a lot harder than they thought.
Because the whole league was planning for this salary cap to go up, three, maybe five million. And it goes up a schmill.
Everyone's saving their schmoney. That's what they're doing.
And everyone's like, okay, we can make it work. And now you have, like, guys, go to Cap Friendly. Just go there, and it's like,
just go to Cap Friendly just to give them a click. Like, they're so good. Cap Friendly's wonderful.
There's three teams that have over $5 million in cap space.
So it was Arizona, Buffalo.
Nope.
Oh, Arizona,
Anaheim,
Montreal.
Oh, I forget the third one. Doesn't matter. Arizona,
the Colorado Avalanche, because they're so damn good.
I think it might be Chicago.
Oh, it's probably Chicago. It's definitely Chicago.
It's, well, Chicago's near, but it's like outside of those bottom three teams, like, so, there's like the cap space on these teams goes from zero to like $1.8 million.
Yeah, so there's a huge crunch. So my question I would give to you is, can you see the connecting dots of their thought process where now they've gotten to the point where this Boudreau bump thing, the Bruce, there it is, has fizzled and it's gone away and it doesn't exist. But the most alarming thing is that this core group of players are not a team.
No, and I don't think they want to be a team.
Yeah, and then in this front office's mind, moving forward from now, like he kept saying, from now to the beginning of next season, which I think is them, white flag. I think that is done. It's done. So we're in a different ball game now. And I don't think, I'm going to take a second. I'm sorry. We need to clearly define for once and for all that there are multiple personal definitions of a rebuild and multiple personal definitions of a retool. To some people, a rebuild is, let's break it down to the studs, have journeyman AHL players through the roster, be salary compliant, and completely tank. And that's what a rebuild entails.
The Buffalo Sabres.
The Buffalo Sabres tanking for Connor McDavid in 2015. Like that. A retool, some people believe a rebuild, like my definition of a rebuild, is you have a young core that is not surrounded by, I would say, high-performing players on large tickets that, A, can still perform. Like, for example, Buffalo, they had a player like Colicposo making a lot of money. He's the captain, but is he scoring 30, 40 goals this season? No, but you just have an ancillary, and then you allow these young players to build and find their identity. That's another idea for a rebuild. Retool.
I would, as you're saying this, I'm kind of thinking about my
like your definition. Yeah.
My definition, I think of Buffalo tanking for Connor McDavid. I think about the Shannon plan. But honestly, the Shannon plan, you know, kind of reminds me of what's happening in Vancouver. They've got Nazem Kadri. Well, if you think about what's untouchable, if they can move everything, they had Nazem, you know, they have
JVR, Kadri,
Morgan Riley. And Bozak.
Oh, okay. At that point,
yeah. They had some guys.
They had Nazem. They had Morgan Riley. Yeah, they had JVR. They had Phil. Yeah, they had Phil at the time for like one season.
Phil was there. Yeah. And yeah, so, Bozak, you know, it's you can still have those kind of players on the team, but it's like the decisions you make, everything else around that is to
right.
accumulate as much as possible, improve your odds, improve as many, get as many draft picks,
right.
get as many prospects. So I kind of see that in Vancouver. You have your untouchables. You have your 2.5 untouchables.
Right.
You know what? You've got some UFAs that they're not going anywhere. Nobody can afford them. Don't worry about it.
Yep.
And then you start acquiring. You take on some bad contracts. You do what you can. But like, you know, we're jumping ahead. But it's you got Mikheyev for a while. You re-sign Kuzmenko. You got JT Miller. Great.
OEL's going to be here
until the summer when they buy him out.
Yeah. So. Can I pitch something to you?
But there's rebuilds, there's retools.
Right.
I'm thinking retool. You brought it up a couple weeks ago. Dallas Stars, they retool. They have one very strong draft, and now they're a brand new team, and they're amazing.
I quickly got to ask you. Ryan, would you agree that I think we need to introduce tanking or tank as its own term? It needs to be tank, rebuild, retool.
Those are the three. I'd agree with you.
They're, because rebuilding and tanking are getting too synonymous with each other.
Yes.
And there is a clear definition between the two. You can rebuild a team and not necessarily be tanking.
Yep.
Like you're rebuilding the a tank is like you're literally nuking your SimCity city.
Well, you know? We need Dustin Tokarski in here right now to win us some games.
Tokarski. Remember. So my definition of retool will forever go back to the Flyers and what Phil Holmgren did with Jeff Carter and Mike Richards. I've talked about this on the podcast. The quote I will die for is Phil Holmgren. It is the exact definition of a retool. He said, I don't know if we're going to be a better team. I don't know if we're going to be a worse team, but we're going to be a different team. That's exactly what a retool is. If you are shuffling the deck chairs, you are changing things up, you don't know if the moves you're going to make are going to make you better, if they're going to make you substantially worse, but you cannot stay stagnant in the same place and die a slow death.
Oh, we're going to pivot a little bit from there because they're going to be a different team. I don't want, like, you know, with all the reports that are coming out, that Rick Tocchet's going to be the next head coach.
Sergei Gonchar might be the... Listen, I think that's great. I think
sure. Yeah. If they're going to play structured defense, if they are going to have a semblance of, you know, a strategy, that's great. Do I like that it's an old boys club that's not nepotism, but hiring your friends and his NHL head coaching experience is with the most boring team in NHL history? Absolutely not. But what I would really like is when Bo Horvat gets traded away from here, and there is. The Canucks are a little rudderless. That's when I want them to make the change.
Yeah.
And let Bruce keep having showing up, having fun, getting paid. But when Bo goes and maybe a couple other guys go, maybe Tyler Myers, maybe somebody else, Luke Shen, when that leadership void kind of disappears, like in the snap of the fingers, like it did after the 2020 team, that's when I want a bit more of a hard ass with a direction and Rick Tocchet to come in and right the ship, because this team is, if they don't, and it's just, they're just going to be chaos going into the off season, and that could be even more detrimental. Bring them in, right the ship, give them a bit of a leader.
Well, you look at what Philadelphia did, and in terms of changing culture, there are very few head coaches that come with the culture change tag where you know that it doesn't matter what players are there. The person who's like Keenan, I believe Mike Keenan would count for one. John Tortorella counts for one. Can you think of any other?
Mike Babcock.
Let's hope Bab stays out of
Barry Trotz.
Barry Trotz. Well, Barry Trotz. I'm thinking of like people, and this is the problem with these certain coaches that we're talking about. Maybe not specifically Barry Trotz.
No, he doesn't.
But there's
completely change the way you approach the game.
They come in and they have a very short shelf life because after a while players tune out and then players take over in terms of okay, we're just not, you know, this guy isn't going to run the franchise. We're the ones actually playing the game. That's what I hope happens. I feel very bad for Bruce Boudreau. I felt for him when Jim came out and he said that, you know, Bruce is still our coach today.
But I did like when he's like, Bruce is a friend of mine. I like Bruce. Bruce has done a good job here. But it's like, we all knew if, you know, Bruce was not the coach that this organization needed.
Mm-hmm.
He, especially when you're looking to kind of rein things in and get the train back on the track, you don't need Bruce Boudreau who just like, we're not playing defense. We're here to score as many goals as possible.
We're here to have fun. And like, that's great. But then
there's a lot of guys on the team.
You get a sugar crash after, and you're like, oh man. Listen, drinking's fun, and then you get the check. You get TD calling you, being like, you bought how many screwdrivers?
Screwdrivers.
Why and why? Why did you?
I feel bad for Bruce. Mm-hmm. I like that Rutherford, you know, just still said like, hey, this is my buddy, and I like him, and he's done a good job, but you know. He's our coach right now. We all know that this is not the type of coach you need in this role. Mm-hmm. And Bruce knows it. And we talk about fan favorites with Gino off the top of the show. The next head coaching job that Boudreau gets, and he will get one, when he comes to Rogers Arena, they're going to blow the goddamn roof off the building.
He's going to be beloved by this franchise because he endeared himself to this franchise. He was himself. And Bruce... being himself, like, Washington still loves him. Anaheim. Anaheim in Minnesota, I'm sure. Still
they like him.
They like him. so, yeah, I guess to kind of wrap up my thoughts is that we're heading into, I think they also very, very clearly said, like, okay, Bo's, it's done.
Thank God.
The thing I loved, the quote that I loved from Jim today. I'm sorry, but now I'm thinking about it again. There are just quotes that I loved because they were very hyper-specific and true. He came out and he said, we made Bo an offer that we feel is fair comparing to his career up to this year.
Yeah. He's priced himself.
But the thing is, he's having a really great year this year.
Yeah.
And he's like, we're not going to pay a player commensurate to him having one career year when we know the last 7 or 8, he's been, you know, a 30-goal guy. We're not going to pay him like he's 50.
Because he ain't.
And we're going to let someone else do that. If they, you know, if they gave him a 7-8-year deal at 6.5, you know, 6.75, guess what? That is basically the Ryan Nugent Hopkins contract added for inflation and added protection. He's getting what, 5.75 times 7 or 8? Like that's the pocket. That's the pocket where we've always compared him to, and now he's having this career year. RNH having a career year this year as well.
Yeah, great.
Right, that's great. But now we have to resign. Are you going to re-sign RNH for what he's doing this year? Or are you going to re-sign him for what he's told, basically said, you know, I'm 27, this is what I am?
And, you know, by the what we've talked about is, you know, how cash-strapped everybody is. Bo might not get that $8 million, 7-8-year deal like he's thinking, you know, that he could be worth right now. He might... go and get a Ryan Nugent Hopkins deal or the dreaded Tyler Toffoli-like deal, maybe a bit more. But the point is, you can't dwell on that because he didn't want that from the Canucks. He's out there to get as much money as possible, and if he comes back with a $5.5 million deal and he's making the same for 8 years, well, I mean, that's what it is.
Yeah.
That's what, because you don't want him signing now when he's worth 8 in the market.
You absolutely
allegedly
don't. Yeah.
You want him, go out to July, go see what you can get. And be like Steven Stamkos.
Mm-hmm.
If you think you're worth more, go out and get it. If you want to play somewhere else, go get it.
Go get the money, and then guess what? If Steven Stamkos went, well, okay, this is a weird comparison to make to the Canucks, but it's like you do think about it. If Steven Stamkos took that money from Tirana,
yeah.
Well, guess what? He doesn't win 2 Stanley Cups in a row. So...
Let's pivot. We'll go into Sauce It or Toss It in a second, but I was listening to a really good podcast today.
Really good.
And it did crack up where I'm like, man, the Leafs are really boring this year. I haven't had any vested interest in them. I usually like to. It's usually a little chaotic. They got their nose to the grindstone this year, and they're like, yeah, it's like a 95% chance they're going to play the Lightning in the playoffs.
Sick, dude. I am... Guys, okay, I know we have Leaf listeners. I love you all. Mm-hmm. I hope you're having a great start to your year.
Enjoy the dominant, pleasant, unremarkable year. Very 2011
Yeah,
vibes.
You guys have two decent goalies. Question. Unforgivably, I haven't seen a lot of Toronto Maple Leafs games. What's happening with Austin Matthews? What's his deal?
He's
injured?
He can't comment on who pays him $3 million a year.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's got a nagging injury. He's only got 21 goals right now.
I mean, that's okay. That's not... I mean, well, 20... No, 21's all right.
He was a 60-banger last year.
Yeah, I don't know, man. He's thinking about those retro Coyotes jerseys, and he's like... I don't know if I want to go back yet.
Me and Connor.
Me and Connor, baby. Me and Bedard.
On that Connor...
34 plus 98. I can't do math.
We're at the point of the show before we go into Sauce It or Toss It where we need to ask these people to do some things.
Yep.
Maybe they can support the show monetarily at...
Patreon.com/PucksOnNet Ka?
Just no CA. No Ka.
PucksOnNet.com/PucksOnNet support us. Support Ryan and I and Gita for creating this wonderful show and fostering this community. We know that... We always tell you money's tough, and you know what? Money is really tough. And to be fair, you know, we're talking about going to Costco all the time. Some people don't even have a Costco card. So who are we to ask you for money?
Exactly. But if you can find it in your budget, in your new year, new budget,
yep.
$5 American a month will get you all the access to bonus content,
yep.
Early releases, the interview uh-huh. we did earlier, coming up later, we aired earlier.
Uh-huh.
Pucks in at Discord, you can hop into that. You can get 5 minutes for paying, which we're going to record after that. Everything you could possibly want and then some. And if you want more, just tell us. We'll give you more.
Yeah, and if you want, tell me and I'll hop on Dota under a Smurf account and raise your MMR.
Sure.
Thousands of MMR by destroying little kids who...
whatever that down. Means, whatever yeah. he just said, he'll do. And if you don't want to support the show monetarily, that's perfectly fine. Go to youtube.com/pucksonnet. Hit subscribe, smash the bell, all the things those Logan Paul brothers tell you to do. There's going to be an alternate commentary game, I think, for Wednesday against the yep. Tampa Bay Lightning where they wear a skate.
Nice.
That'll be
the skate.
Yeah, that's not an inside job at all.
How excited are you for the newest season of Succession?
Never seen it.
Anyway, guys, thanks for listening to this plug.
Go to follow us on Instagram, follow us on TikTok. We put content out there every week and just help spread the word of this show. Tell a friend, force them to listen, drive them on the commute to work and make them listen.
And heads up and shout out to Pucks on Net and Raystar Royco.
Well, here, let's do Sauce It or Toss It, because you can do both those
Ooh,
things.
Ooh, I can. Sauce me, toss me, wine me, dine me, get me home
619
by
619 you.
Booyaka, booyaka. All right. the custody of Dominic ladder match. Let's go.
Arash, Sauce It or Toss It.
Yes.
Active NHL players should not have sports gambling sponsorships.
Should not. No, absolutely not. There was a great Twitter post. I think it was referencing to Gino or no, sorry. It was, I remember now. Ryan, do you remember when PK donated the money for that new wing at the Montreal Children's Hospital? And people were like giving him flack for like saying like, yeah, I'm, you know, instead of doing the Sedin thing where the Sedins donated $1 million to Canucks Place and didn't say anything to anyone, PK was like, yeah, I went out and I did this like social endeavor and this is what I did because I'm gregarious and that's just, I'm just saying that I did this, and he put his face towards it. And people were like, oh, PK, how dare he do this? Let, you know,
take him out of town.
I would rather the children get sick than PK have to do this. This is disgraceful. Ah, tabernak, you know, whatever. I don't know if I can say tabernak, and maybe if you're listening to this in Montreal, and
you can tell him if you can or not.
If you've been arrested because I just swore in French, you just let me know. But so remember, they gave PK that criticism.
Yeah.
Where are all those same people when you have Connor McDavid, Austin Matthews, Wayne Gretzky selling you your kids to be like us, gamble?
Hey, Dad, what's a same game? What's a same day parlay?
Well, once you get out of the hospital in Montreal, we'll tell you, son. Let's go. But you know, it's a great point. It's just I get a nugget for you guys to think about. Because to me, when I read that tweet, I was like, yeah, like what? My dad's incredibly uncomfortable with it. He asked me. I can't sports gamble a little bit, but I do it in incredible moderation.
It's very strange to see how much the NHL and media has embraced it on.
I just think if you want to get specific celebrities and like Aaron Paul, sure, like whatever. But athletes, when they're tailored to younger kids and they have this looking up kind of mentality, I think it's kind of gross.
Yeah. Sauce it or toss it. Yeah. You got to trade Andre Kuzmenko.
Sauce it. He's going to be 26. Listen, okay. He's going to be... They are in a position where they potentially, even with Andre Kuzmenko, who's going to be 27 in... Who's going to be 27 in February.
Mm-hmm.
He's not like a fresh 26. He's going to be 27 in February. They're in a position where they could potentially have multiple draft picks in the first round of the 2023 draft.
Yeah, maybe that's a sauce it or toss it for tomorrow.
I'm just...
Could the Canucks have 3 draft picks in the first round?
Like, they technically could, but yeah. I know they're not... I know maybe reports are coming out that they're not looking for picks, but I'm like, listen, if, you know, they're in a deal where they're getting, like... I don't see a situation... Like, run with me for a second, Ryan. They trade Bo Horvat, 50% retained, to the Colorado Avalanche.
Mm.
You're getting Alex Newhook back. Who else are you getting back? What other...
Kale McCarr.
Sure. Okay, well, that defeats
Nathan
my...
Nathan McKinnon.
No. So let's say it's Alex Newhook. For whatever reason, I don't know. Sammy Girard is thrown in there. This is complete hypothetical. Because Sammy Girard is one player on the Avalanche roster that Avalanche players or fans are saying, well, we might have to move him because we need cap space. We need money for the future. So it's Newhook, Girard. There's something else maybe missing there, because you're also, by taking Girard back, you're taking money back. So he's $5 million for whatever. So how do you balance all that? How draft picks are used as a way of balancing trades out. So even if they might not be looking for it, it's an asset that they can take to either draft a player or they can go and use it to get something else.
Yeah.
So don't be afraid that, oh, they're just not going to get, I don't know. I wanted to throw some water on that.
Speaking of water, sauce it or toss it, All-Star Dunk Tank is a new level of laziness for the NHL marketing team.
Sauce, I am waiting for Machine Gun Kelly to get dunked into a water tank by who's the most boring NHL All-Star I can think of. Kevin Hayes is going to, Kevin Hayes is pretty funny, but.
It's Logan Thompson.
Logan Thompson, Logan Thompson is going to throw a knuckleball at Machine Gun Kelly to get him dunked in the tank, and then.
I was listening to the NHL guy on the Winter Classic, and it's like, listen, there's going to be golf, but there's going to be a bit of a twist on golf. I'm like, so they're gonna play hockey, they're gonna shoot hockey pucks. And then he basically said it. I'm like, they did that in Vegas where they had to shoot, like, there was some fountain
and it
game
took forever.
Yeah, I'm like, just fuck, just come on.
Who can, okay, like, there should be a game who's like, all right, so the last person to give up watching Casino on a complete loop without breaking wins, and it's just like a 4-day stream of like players just hooked up, like it's Clockwork Orange, like watching Casino. And it's just,
can we watch Goodfellas?
No. It's Robert De Niro being like, look how many blueberries your muffin has. Look how many mine has. I mean, yours is overflowing, breaking apart. I got nothing here. Everything in this town, you got. If you don't do it yourself, doesn't get done. I want an equal amount of blueberries in every muffin. And that's my favorite part of Casino. It's the baker who's like, do you know how long that's going to take? I don't care how long it takes. I want an equal amount. Equal amount.
Here's how you fix the All-Star game. The four divisions play a softball or flag football tournament.
I'm talking softball for me.
Here's a softball for you. Sauce it or toss it. The worst contract on the Vancouver Canucks is Oliver Ekman-Larsson.
I mean, if I don't say sauce it, people are going to be like, he's an idiot. But I mean, okay. Like, the worst contract to me is the Tucker Pullman contract, because in no way, shape, form in God's history of mankind should he ever have been given that contract. There is no justification. Like, there is zero. Like, I remember when the signing was announced, people were like, they're like, we don't know why this is happening, but it is. So we don't know why he got this money, but he did. So this is a thing that happened.
So he's here.
Like with OEL, at least I can understand. All right. It was for a really long time in the 2010s, you know, he's like legit number one pair, Olympic gold medal winning, number one stud D man. Yeah, I get it. But I mean, you know, we'll see. I don't know. We'll see with the OEL deal. I mean, he's only 31, but we'll see if he takes accountability and gets a little bit healthy, and maybe a new coach comes in. Sergei Gonchar coming in.
There you go.
Reeking of the vodka. Coming in being like, hello.
I'm Stanley Cup champion.
I am Stanley Cup champion, Sergei Gonchar.
Toss it or toss it.
People call me the Gonch. Never have I known what it means. But you have to understand. Rick Tock does not like little defensemen. I love little. I was little defenseman. Quinn, No. Quinn, come here. Come here. I want to tell you, you're valued. Rick, he has different way of talk.
Sorry, I'm going to go forever. Certain Russian listeners of this podcast who also love Oliver Ekman-Larsson will probably DM me now and be like, that was the worst Russian accent I've ever heard in my life.
Auston Matthews won't score 40 goals this year. Sauce it or toss
it. He's going to get 40. Come on, next.
So far, the 2022-23 NHL season is... Boring.
Pretty boring. There's not enough trades. There's just this is a Western where everyone's holstered their guns and it's like, God damn it.
We're waiting for the final scene.
God, there's Sergio Leone fucking wide shots and shit. Just someone shoot a gun. Next.
Sauce it or toss it. $5 draft beers in this economy.
Ding, 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 ding. We are going to sauce it like it's this Katy Perry skip the dish. No, I'm gonna toss the Katy Perry skip the dish commercial. Yeah, man, let me tell you. When I go to a place and I know American listeners are going to make $5. Dang, Bobby. What? But to Canadians.
Tall boy can of Alamo beer in Ireland.
What? oh, hell yeah. Let me tell you, in Canada, stuff is a little pricey. But if I can go to a place like Ryan, you went to the new local bar. Apparently, the vibes are good.
Yeah, we'll go there.
And we hope that the really, really cool hipster crowd of the first week or two dies off a little bit. And so it goes back to being like, you know, I don't have to wear fucking, you know, I can just walk in and just like not feel like I'm in, you know, like a... I'm going to see an underground cover band of LCD Sound System and James Murphy's going to be there and everyone's doing coke, but they also have four kids, but they also live in kits because their parents assimilated here 15 years ago. So they're like, oh, I don't pay rent and I work for...
What are you projecting?
Just whites. The whites. Anyway.
$5 draft beers.
Oh, hell yeah. Love it.
All right. On that note,
yeah,
we'll toss this. I'll put on a different shirt. You'll duck out, and I'll conduct my interview with Chuck Tatham. And yeah, it'll be it's executive producer of Offside, the Harold Ballard Story, and that'll be on CBC, our good old fashioned CBC, on Sunday, January 22nd, and then be able to stream on CBC Gem following that. Well, I'd be remiss if we didn't discuss the Offside, the Harold Ballard Story documentary that's coming out on CBC Gem on January 22nd. I got an advanced copy. I absolutely loved the hell out of it. I finished it last night.
Thank you, sir.
As you mentioned, you know, I'm of a bit of a younger generation and on the West Coast, so we only really got the legend of Harold Ballard. I've, you know, unless I'm going down a Wikipedia or YouTube wormhole, I'm not really, you know, getting the whole story or getting, you know, the legacy he had, the positive and or the negative, and now after this documentary, the odd positive impact he had on the region. I'm just really curious, what was the inspiration behind putting this film together?
Well, thanks, Ryan. Michael Geddes was one of the executive producers with me and Jason Priestley. And a few years ago, I don't recall what I was working on with Michael, but he said to me, he said, nobody's ever done anything on Ballard. And I couldn't believe it. I could not believe it. And so we did a little bit of digging and got a lot of interest from a lot of different people. And it's the first documentary I've ever done. You know, I'm a sitcom writer, but it never occurred to me to do a documentary because documentaries are generally fairly straight ahead and compelling, interesting, and everything else. But Ballard was such a clown that, and I knew growing up in Guelph, Ontario, an hour west of Toronto, growing up with Ballard on the front page every day, I was like, I cannot believe that the Steinbrenner, basically the George Steinbrenner of hockey, has never been properly, you know, discussed. And so Michael and Jason and I sat down with, as you know from watching the documentary, a lot of old Leafs, a lot of executives, and got a lot of different perspectives on Ballard. Some, as you say, not surprisingly negative, but some surprisingly positive.
Yeah.
Know? Yeah.
One thing that stood out, you know, not to throw too many spoilers, but, you know, surprisingly positive was, you know, Tiger Williams in the doc, where he's running him down essentially, and then kind of has a realization mid speech that, oh, this guy was like a grandpa. I loved him. Like, I couldn't believe that earnest moment you had with Tiger. Were people hesitant to speak on Harold Ballard?
I don't think people were hesitant to speak. We reached out to Dave Keon.
Mm-hmm.
And Dave Keon, I don't know if we got Dave Keon or Dave Keon's people, but he had no interest. And that one was one where I think, and this is a bit of conjecture, I don't think Dave would have had anything, I dare say, good to say about Harold Ballard. I don't think he was interested in revisiting that because he had a very bad time with him. But, I mean, when you think of the fact that Lanny McDonald and Daryl Sittler both had pretty rough experiences with Ballard.
Yeah.
And they were both happy to be very candid and very even-handed and very sensible. I wouldn't say anybody was reluctant. What was interesting is a lot of the people involved are no longer with us, you know. Yeah. So we did rely on some of the old guard that are still around, and then the players, and all the players came in and looked like they could still play. I mean, it was kind of cool, you know, and it was kind of cool, like, Wendell Clark drove down from Sudbury, all the way from Sudbury, for the interview.
Most Canadian sentence ever said.
That's right. Did you? But Wendell Clark drove down from Sudbury, and he came in and he said, I think I just ran out of gas. Like, I think like the last 100 yards, he was out of gas. So I have photos, if anybody wants them. I do have photos after the interview of Wendell with a gas tank out in the street in Toronto, filling up the old pickup truck. But everybody, I think, was happy to be on the record. And guys like Jim McKenney, of course, if you recall McKenney from the 70s, is a classic storyteller. And he was happy to sit down with us and tell some tales.
I, you know, not well versed in all of the Leafs broadcasters and, you know, personnel. So he was a delightful treat. He was a bit of a dark horse of this doc. I loved listening to him speak. What interview kind of gave you the most and kind of gave you the best? Because these are hockey players. They are kind of ingrained to be a little quieter than most.
Yeah, I think they were all interesting. Daryl Sittler just told his tale. Mm-hmm. And the fact that he was the captain of the team, and that meant he felt he had a responsibility to the team and to his teammates. I know he had responsibility to the ownership, and I think he was a very respectful guy, but he just sort of laid out the fact that he just would not complain, but he said, I don't think I was really dealt a proper hand during the Ballard regime. And the fact of the matter is, as people recall, he had a no trade contract. But as the captain, he was the guy who had to go to Ballard and say, you know, this coach, you know, stop firing coaches. Like, you're firing coaches. It was okay. The guy you fired on Tuesday, I can live with, but the guy you fired on Thursday, we should have given him a better chance, you know? But because it was no trade contract, Ballard was frustrated enough to trade his best friend, Lanny McDonald. So despite Daryl Sittler, Harold Ballard traded a future Hall of Famer. And Sittler was very candid. Also, Rick Vive openly, I think from the documentary, you can see he, the first Leaf to score 50 goals, three consecutive seasons, and Ballard would not pay him what he was worth. And he
looked like he was seething through a lot of his comments, like gritting his teeth, like, ugh.
He's extraordinarily pleasant, articulate, fun guy to be with. But you're right, mentioning Ballard got his back up a little bit, and justifiably so. I mean, you know, the guy was not well treated. And to your point, if somebody like Tiger Williams thinks he was well treated, he's going to have good stories. If someone like Daryl or Rick Vive realized at the time and now that they were mistreated by Ballard and by a lot of times by Punch Imlach, the fairly obnoxious general manager who was there, as you recall, in the 60s when they won the Cups. And when Ballard brought him back after his tenure in Buffalo, the game had passed Punch Imlach by. He went from like tyrannical mastermind to just tyrant, you know.
I absolutely loved it. There's a sequence where you're showing him in the Stanley Cup parade and he looks like a normal middle-aged older dude, and then he's at that practice and all the guys are waving in the background of the practice and he looks like he's aged 30 years in a decade.
This is a guy who did have multiple heart situations, right?
Of course,
heart attacks and bypasses. And as far as stress is concerned, the story that goes, he had a bypass, I believe, and read in the paper in recovery that he might be out as the general manager of the Leafs in the second tenure. So he got out of the hospital, apparently, and drove over to Maple Leaf Gardens and to discover his parking spot was missing. And but Gord Stellick was the young, you know, the young Leafs executive at the time who came out. And apparently Punch said something like, hey, have I been fired? And Gord said, I'm not sure, but I've been told if you come by every week, I can give you your mail. It was kind of a circus.
Bit of a circus. Now, like I mentioned earlier, like, you know, Harold Ballard is, you know, the stories and the information you hear about him are almost like that of legend, and, you know, kind of grow and with, you know, with more and more mystique, and like the famous story of him selling two Beatles shows without a contract. I kind of got the sense that everybody interviewed wasn't sure what was true and what was...
Well, I think what was true, the Beatles did indeed show up with their Brian Epstein, their manager, and Ballard said, you're doing
playing too.
And Epstein was like, that's not in the contract. And Ballard said, there's going to be a riot. I sold things to do. I'm afraid my hands are tied. Your hands are tied because you sold tickets to two concerts. So that, I believe, is true. The Ballard turned off the water taps, you know, to the water fountain, and turned on the heat or turned off the air conditioning. I think speaking to Gord Stellick, he said, first of all, if you find a water fountain in Maple Leaf Gardens, tell me. And secondly, What's the deal with turning off the air conditioning in a hockey rink? That did not happen. You know, it's just, you know, so there was a bit of exaggeration with regard to that story. But the Beatles did play shows at, I guess, 7 and 10, which is crazy. Could you imagine, you know, like if U2 shows up at the, you know, the Chicago United Center now, yeah. you boys are playing at 5 and 9, you know, it's the, you know. But a different time, very different time.
Well, luckily the Beatles only played 25 minutes and then ran into their armored car, right?
Yes, they did. And you couldn't hear what they were, you know, singing anyway because of the screaming. But a lot of fun. And that was the same era when Ballard let Muhammad Ali fight Shivalo. Yeah. And nobody else would let Ali fight because he was considered a draft dodger. But Ballard, I think, dollar signs. So, I mean, he would have put anybody. He put in the Billy Graham religious revivals. He put in wrestling. He put in anything to fill seats. And one of the interesting things was he thought, how can I make money from an empty seat? And people would say, well, you can't make money from an empty seat. He said, yes, I can. Yes, I can. I'm going to get at advertising. And so at Maple Leaf Gardens for years, when a seat was empty, it was flipped up and it says Schick Razors. There was a logo there. So he really, every possible way to generate revenue, Harold Ballard was right on top of it.
The film, like, kind of, you know, I would say it humanizes him, you know, based on the information, you know, based on the lore and the history and the stories, and then based on, you know, the stories that you gathered and the footage you've accumulated making this. Was it a goal to humanize him?
It wasn't a goal to humanize him. I think what we discovered before the fact, even, but in talking to people, was that he was, I think, I dare say, a kind of a lonely soul.
Yeah.
And he had his wife Dorothy until she died of cancer in the 60s. But then he immediately had Stafford Smythe, you know, Conn Smythe, the team owner's son, at his side until he died. Then he immediately had King Clancy by his side until he died. Then he had Yolanda McMillan, the late stage girlfriend. And if this documentary does humanize him, that's not the worst thing in the world. I will say, though, that as a guy who had a pretty good knowledge of Ballard before the fact, because he was on the front page of the newspaper every single day when I was a kid. And at that time, I might have been a little bit too young to understand that this guy was single-handedly wrecking the team. But my father, for example, was born in 1927, and he knew when the Leafs were good. They had, you know, they had a bunch of cups, and they were good. And he sort of would say, yeah, Ballard's the problem. That whole generation would say Ballard's the problem. And I guess this is a long way of saying, I don't want to humanize Ballard, although we did, too much, in that he was so greedy and so selfish that he didn't think of the Maple Leafs as a public trust, which they're not, but they were the other huge, massive Canadian hockey franchise. And while Montreal kept winning, Ballard was so greedy, he fired coaches and dumped players, and the team went right in the crapper. Yeah. And so, you know, he's a guy who gave money very, very quietly to, forgive me for one second. I'm going to turn that off. That's my brother calling from Vancouver. He maybe wants to talk about last night's game with the Tampa Bay and the Canucks.
Get him on the horn.
Get him out there. Get us talk. He knows Ballard. My brother was the one that we were sitting in the very back row at Maple Leaf Gardens years ago during the Ballard era. We were like 20 or 15 or something. And these tickets cost us a lot of money, but we were literally in the last row so we could stand up and lean against the wall. And he said, that hockey action that we're that is like light from the sun. We're seeing action that occurred 8 minutes ago. That's how far we are. That's how far we are. And those are the days where you'd go to an early season Leafs game during Ballard. If you ordered a hot dog, it's October. The buns were concrete. They were last year's buns. And so I'm sure they had a warehouse full of last year's buns, and then they trot them out. So the rule was no hot dogs the first couple of Leafs games, because you're watching a terrible hockey team and you're having dental damage. So
yeah, that thing is going to sit in your stomach like a brick for a little bit long.
Yeah.
What are the Leafs thoughts on the Maple Leafs organization thoughts on the project and the finished and the film?
They were very happy. They were very happy. Michael Geddes spent time with Brendan Shanahan, the president of the Leafs, and I mean, I think they're fine with it. We know the Leafs are a proud, successful organization, but we're allowed to look at a time in their history when they were not a proud, good organization. This was Ballard connected the old era of very good Leafs teams to the current era of very good Leafs teams, you know, and the fact that it wasn't instantaneous, but the fact that, you know, within minutes of Ballard's demise, the Leafs started to get better, you know. It was no secret that, of course, the last couple of years of his life, he died in 1990, but they were in the semifinals by 93. I forget who they played. They wound up playing the Leafs. That was the team that beat Gretzky beat to go on to play against the Habs. Yeah. Yeah.
And in 94, they lost to the Canucks in the West Final.
Yes.
So they were a good team in those back then.
Hockey team. And then, of course, as you recall, in 94, Vancouver went on to win. Oh, no, wait a minute.
Listen, we're having a tough decade here. You know, we have our own concerns with meddling ownership or penny pinching ownership or questionable decisions in the Aquilinis. And I'm seeing it throughout the doc. I'm like, well, that's not like that here, or it's not that bad. Or
well, I think back then with Ballard, it was so visceral. It was so of the moment.
Yeah.
He lived in Maple Leaf Gardens. The man moved in, and there you'd see him wandering around in his bathrobe, yelling at people and firing people. And it was just a time. It was so dysfunctional. It was such a circus. And, you know, we felt his story had to be told, and we're glad that we had so many people willing to help tell
it. I absolutely loved I was writing my notes down while I watched it about what I wanted to ask you. And I'm like, You know, where's the footage of his weird apartment? And about 2 minutes later, I'm like, oh, never mind. There it is. I was so glad to see it. I was so curious about, you know, just the idea of like, I think the owner of the Colorado Avalanche and the Denver Nuggets has like a suite or a penthouse at the Ball Arena or whatever it's called. So I'm always fascinated by the eccentric owner living in the building. So I'm
with you all the way. I couldn't believe when we got the footage. The place looked like a little shithole. I mean, I think there's one window. This guy owns the team. He's worth many, many millions. It's a little labyrinthine thing to a back room full of crap. And I don't know if it's visible in the documentary, but he had for reasons unknown, he had a picture of Karl Marx, which makes no sense. He had he had piranhas. I guess his kids gave him
piranhas. Of course he
did. But very shortly after the kids gave him piranhas, one piranha ate the other. And he was like, I guess that's what happened with piranhas. And he had a picture of his deceased wife in there. What a weird place to... And he had a lovely house, by all accounts, and he had all kinds of money. I think he felt very... Ryan, I think he felt very safe in that place. That was his little kingdom, and he felt very safe. So why not move in and just roam around? Because at that time, for those of you out there that aren't that familiar with the Ballard era, he had a bunker. He had a bunker down in the corner of Maple Leaf Gardens where he would watch the game.
The worst sight lines you could possibly have.
The worst sight lines. And... what would happen back in the day is if the Leafs were getting drubbed, he's gone. Like you look at the bunker and there's nobody there by the end of the second period, you know, 9-0 for the, you know, the Minnesota North Stars. Ballard's upstairs eating ice cream in his pajamas, you know. But I said once, I recall as a kid saying, can I go talk to Mr. Ballard?
Yeah.
Because could I walk, you know, because I was down in the good seats. I have no idea how I got there. I must have parachuted down from the top of the arena or something. And people, the usherettes down there, they had lovely female ushers there. It was interesting, Maple Leaf Gardens. The ushers in the cheap seats were chain-smoking guys who were 100.
Yeah.
These guys, they came with the building. The better the better the seats were, the more attractive the ushers were, you know.
It's the damnedest thing.
Isn't that wild how I'd be sitting up in the top of this building eating a concrete hot dog with, like, you know, Methuselah wearing a hat beside me, guiding people to their seats, you know. But I never talked to Ballard, but I did see that he would welcome people who, if the game was going well, he would welcome people and shake hands and say hi.
One of my last questions before we wrap up. Don Cherry is predominantly featured in the film, and he's kind of had his fall from grace. I thought he provided a fair and accurate insight into it, and he provided something that was unique. Was there any hesitations to, you know, include him or not include him in the doc?
It's an interesting question. Don is of a different era.
Mm-hmm.
And Don, I think, to your point, identifies with Ballard. He identifies with that Neanderthal sensibility. So I think as antiquated as his thinking might be, having him in the documentary was a nice representation of that sensibility.
Yeah.
The sensibility was so insensitive and so politically incorrect that, as you say, Don has been sort of canceled for good reason. But I don't think we hesitated. We really, in this documentary, tried to show all sides for all people. And, you know, as you saw in the documentary, we talked to people in their 20s and 30s, journalists of today, who upon looking at footage of Ballard said, oh, my God, this guy would have lasted 4 minutes. I mean, he's totally in his mind is thousands of years old, and his behavior was completely unacceptable. But it was, as I sometimes tell people, Ballard was and he was the biggest patriot. He had Team Canada practicing there, mm-hmm, for the Soviet series. He wouldn't let the commies in for this, and he always this. But he acted like, and this is and I say this with love, he acted more like he was American. And Canadians, yeah, you know, he acted more like a Steinbrenner, like a Trump, a selfish, short-sighted, greedy guy. And it's a sensibility that mercifully, I would say mercifully, doesn't exist anymore, except, of course, I live in the United States.
You live in Florida.
Yeah. Well, I'm in Florida right now, but I'm all over the place. I say that with love, but Canadians didn't know what to do. They did not know what to do with this buffoon, this clown back in 1970, 1980.
Once again, I absolutely loved the documentary. It was something I heard that this documentary was being made, I'm like, this is everything I've wanted, as somebody who's fascinated by the Ballard era and tracking down whatever I can, and, you know, just hearing all these tales. So I absolutely loved it. It comes out on January 22nd on CBC Gem.
It's on CBC Network on the 22nd, and then afterwards it'll be on Gem.
Oh, then
so you can watch it on your television machine over the airwaves on the 22nd at 8 o'clock on CBC.
As somebody who still has boomer cable, I will. I'll make sure to tune in.
What I'm talking about.
I was going through your IMDb just as we wrap up. I just want to thank you because you were a producer on How I Met Your Mother.
Yes.
So
yeah.
I would like to thank you on behalf of British Columbians and Vancouver Canucks fans for incredibly accurate Canuck references throughout the show.
Well, you're very kind. Remember, Kobe Smulders is from Victoria.
She's from Vancouver.
Yeah, she her folks live in Victoria now.
Oh, yeah.
She's from Vancouver. And I guess Carter Bays and Craig Thomas went to her early on the show and said, you're Canadian, so why not, can we make your character Canadian? And she said, well, sure. I mean, to what end? Well, we can talk about cultural differences and some of the nuances between the United States and Canada. I guess Kobe, she told me the story. Sure, why not? She said it was about 1 hour later. We were making jokes about Canadians being afraid of the dark and, you know, drinking their own urine or whatever it was. People would say to me, will this offend Canadians? All these references to Harvey's and a white spot or whatever it was. I remember thinking, as a Canadian, I don't think it'll be offensive. I think maybe it'll be kind of fun and be for these esoteric little Easter eggs, these things. But I will say this, one of my proudest moments was I actually revealed the mother in How I Met Your Mother, because I was up at the office writing and they called me on the stage. And I thought, oh, they're going to call me on the stage. They need some quality comedy from old Chuck. No, they needed me to literally go on camera, because I'm a big guy.
Yeah.
And in front of the actress, Kristen Milioti. And then action, I moved out of the way to reveal her. So I was there on stage because I look like Lurch. And I just I revealed the mother, but and you can't even see me. I'm shot from like the chest down, but that was a proud moment. I was always delighted with the Canadian references in How I Met Your Mother, and I was thrilled that Canada. Thank you very much, my friend, for getting a kick out of the references.
Well, like, I mean, Robin Sparkles was a Halloween costume in all across this country for many years. Like, I think they were all well received because, you know, you had a character as strong as Colby to like stand up for those Canadian things. Like, it wasn't like, let's dump on Canada for 30 minutes. It was like, no. Like, hey, shut up. It's cool.
Yeah, exactly.
But the one thing that stood out was, and well, you know, I won't talk you off about a show from 10 years ago, but there's the episode where they're talking about ways to rile up Colby and like get her angry. And it was one of the things they write on the chalkboard or the whiteboard was like the 2004 Vancouver Canucks. What was it called? Northwest Division title. And then she says the diminishing play of Trevor Linden and bad acquisitions. And I'm like, shit. Yeah, that's all right. And they didn't replace Todd Bertuzzi. We got suspended at the trade deadline or at right before the deadline. So it was accurate as hell. And I think a lot of Canucks fans and a lot of Canadians just absolutely enjoyed that about that show.
Well, thank you. The I got to meet everybody from Luke Robitaille to Geddy Lee to Alex Trebek. Like when we were to Katie Lang when we were doing this series, and the Canadiana Carter and Craig, who are the greatest guys in the world, they just said, "Oh, let's go all in on Canada. We're gonna have a good time with Canada." And my son, my elder son Trevor, is actually in the episode with it's the big reveal at the hockey rink. Where there's an enormous Canadian, it's a I forget the name of the episode. Mm-hmm. You'll get some message. I think it might be an episode that I wrote, where Ted is dressed like Liberace skating around. I forget what we had a lot of body doubles and a lot of fun that day.
Playing the organ at Madison Square Garden or something.
Something like that. It was something like that. But very Canadian episode, and I got to spend a lot of time on that ice. And Video Village, where we watched the monitors and the set, it had to be off the ice.
Yeah.
And then, of course, the set was on the ice and I had my hockey skates. So I was the messenger between, we need you to stand 6 inches to the left. And I'd skate over and tell somebody, you know, to Jason Siegel, move a little, or whoever was there. And then I'd skate back and forth. Had a nice workout that day. But,
I absolutely love that one of the Canadians on set, go home and get your skates. You know, that's a cliche. That's a stereotype. I don't have that. I mean, I do, but maybe they're not sharp. Ah, shit, they are sharp.
Yes, they are sharp. Yes. Well, I would skate over there and skate back, and people would say, show off. And I go, show off? All I did was skate, you know. I mean, anyone who's played hockey with me knows that when I skate, it's not pretty. You ain't watching Trevor Linden, you know, but
a lot of wasted movement.
Well, I'll say, by the way, I worked on another show called Arrested Development.
Yes, you did.
And Will Arnett, I met him, you know, I didn't know Will. And I said, I'm a kind of a hockey fan. You're from Toronto. He said, yeah. Yeah, you're a hockey fan. I said, yeah. You know what the five hole is? I said, of course I know what the five hole is. And we had a nice time. That was the name of his production company.
Oh,
and,
really? That's awesome.
That's a hockey fan. When you name it Five Hole Productions, that's a hockey fan.
I've enjoyed the hell out of this whole conversation. It's been the most Canadian conversation ever. I want to thank the plumber for not showing up on time.
Yes.
And I appreciate the hell out of you spending time talking about this doc and some of your other projects. It's been a great conversation.
Well, thank you, Ryan. The plumber, I'm sure, will show up at some point. Well, there's a ding on my phone right now. I'm sure he's downstairs with his wrench ready to fix the sink. Thank you for taking the time to sit with me. Thank you, everybody, for listening. The documentary is on Sunday, the 22nd, on CBC, and then Gem thereafter. I am in Florida. I am going down to the beach. So...
Why wouldn't you?
Why wouldn't I? Thanks very much. Okay.
All right. Great. That was a great conversation with Chuck. Please go watch that show on Sunday.
What's the name of the show again?
Offside.
Offside, the Harold Ballard story?
Not to be confused with Offside, the Sean Avery autobiography I have on my bookshelf.
And just like the definition of rebuild, there are multiple ideas of what offside really mean.
Let's power through some questions. Yep. These are going to be a little more rapid fire.
Let's go.
And then we're going to do trivia where I hand it over to Mr. Hand it to Mr. Mamarzadeh. Arash, this comes from Ryan Hank, Always 94.
Yeah, also no. Ryan Hank, no. I will not be answering your other question. How the lack of respect.
He asked it on both platforms, too.
It's just the lack of respect of our restaurant. You were at Pomegranate. You think we'd actually that we'll allow that to happen? First of all, my dad's bald.
Yeah, where do you think it went?
I knew something was off with the sauce years ago. Anyway.
Was Edler looking off Brock on the power play so impactful that his game has never evolved? For a little context, there was a power play. I can't remember what year it was.
What year? There was always power play where like he would. It was before.
Oh yeah, yeah.
It was Edler just would not sauce it to Brock,
and he's just sitting there.
He's just like,
I'm ready,
Eagle.
he's Danny Heatley.
He's Danny Heatley in the corner. Ryan, that was great.
Another one, Alex Burton. Do you agree that the Canucks use Brock Besser in the wrong place on the power play? He should be where Miller is, creating two dangerous one-timers from the top of each circle, EP40 being the right side threat. I agree. I wouldn't mind a little shift to position for all those cats on the power on PP1, but Brock Besser is a shooter. He's got a good shot. Put him in a spot to use his shot.
Okay, but where do you put JT Miller then?
Who cares?
No, just wait. Where do you put JT Miller, who over the past few seasons has been one of the most predominant power play producers in the NHL? I think if you didn't have JT Miller, sure, yeah, put Besser on the left half boards for that one timer and the hash mark shot. But where do you put JT Miller?
Like, does a power play one have to be the same unit all the time?
It's not, but I mean, like, you have...
Swap them off.
I just feel like there are just certain players that produce so much. Like, it's all about performing rates. So it's, you know...
Yeah, I agree, and I also don't really care for Brock Besser on the ice.
I mean,
so.
We all know your love affair.
But it has always been strange... As for a very long time, where it seemed like he had to scratch and claw for passes on the power play.
I think, you know what, to answer the question, I think, hey, in the next, they got, 40-some-odd games left? Try everything out.
Yeah, inflate that trade value.
Inflate that trade value.
Matt Pisco, best pizza you ever had, not in the lower mainland?
Oh.
So
not even at my restaurant.
You're at the lower mainland.
Yeah.
I'm going to be honest. I haven't had a lot of pizza outside the lower mainland. There's some pizza in Squamish at the House Sound Brewing that really knocked my socks off. A forager pizza. It was vegetarian. Amazing. Some pizza in Toronto that was Neapolitan style that I didn't really care for.
I'm trying to think. There was this pizza in Japan I had that was really, really, really,
he just
really,
ordered
really
pizza
good.
From Japan.
Sushi from Japan.
I know.
Posty.
I'm doing it.
It was this great, it was like a sardine pizza. It was actually very, very good.
Okay. Yeah. But I when I saw this question, I'm like, surely I have an answer for that. I don't.
Yeah, well, to give more of a specific answer for like British Columbia that isn't, like, it's like the Fraser Valley's not Lower Mainland, right?
It's still Lower Mainland.
Oh, shoot.
Lower Mainland also... No. Yeah, it's... Yeah, that's still Chilliwack.
Yeah, then... Okay, I don't know.
We don't have answers. We're not learned, cultured people.
Yeah.
Roger R. Smith, Cool Indian 101. Quinn Hughes speaking on Tanner Pearson's injury. Do you feel it was Quinn's place to do that?
Do I feel it was Quinn's place to do that? I mean, players are... The player culture is probably going to say, no, it's not. But I feel like... Hey man, you have a feeling there's not stuff coming out and you're in a situation where the organization hasn't answered on it specifically and you're frustrated and you want to come out and just make your opinion heard, go for it.
He didn't dump on the team, he dumped on the situation.
Yep.
And that little comment, all of this transpired from that comment, so it doesn't offend me.
Yep.
Roger Smith, who is a proud Indigenous man, he sent a photo to us on Twitter of his late uncle meeting Gino.
I'm gonna switch over to the Pucks on Net account right now, and I am gonna look at this photo very quickly.
Shoot me in
Sir Rod.
I'll go to your mentions.
In our mentions.
Yeah. Just.
Let's scroll.
Yeah, check that.
Oh.
Giving him a piece of Indigenous art.
Yo.
Yeah. That's pretty damn cool.
Uncle Arn.
Yeah.
What a stash on that man. What a suit.
Gino.
Hell
making, yeah. Making time.
Dude, that is a fit that I miss.
What the?
Look at Uncle Arn. Look at him.
Yeah, he's looking great. He's,
oh, he just has, he's like, done.
I like that he's done up to go to the rink.
He's done up going to the rink because he knows it's like this is where business is done.
Speaking of business. Speaking of business.
It's business time. Ryan's about to do trivia. And we hope that it's consistently good again because it was really good last
week. Let's get easy.
All right. What's the theme of this trivia tonight?
Current events.
Oh God! Okay, don't ask me about.
Okay, we'll maybe talk about this in 5 minutes of paying. But we went into Pomegranate yesterday for lunch, with listener and dear friend of the show Travis Elliott and his loving wife Kaylin. Yeah, I'm really.
What does that have to do with current events?
You'll see. We walk in. And Arash is like, got a good parlay going, guys.
Yeah, which I didn't even.
And he didn't even make the parlay anyway.
Yeah, because I was too busy working.
He was saying Martin Neches.
Yeah, I thought Martin Neches would get a point.
Yeah, so he didn't.
And also Carolina didn't win.
He also didn't make the
parlay. But I hit the other one, Carolina scoring.
Martin Neches was drafted in 2017. Who's the leading scorer from the 2017 NHL entry draft?
2017?
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to remember. Is that the Elias Pettersson draft?
Yes, it is.
It's Elias Pettersson.
That is correct.
Okay.
Elias Pettersson scored the Forsberg goal on Sunday against the Carolina Hurricanes.
Right.
Amazing goal. Absolutely loved it. Peter Forsberg scored that goal in the 1994 Winter Olympics.
Yep.
He scored against Team Canada. There were... Hang on. 1, 2, 3. Technically 4 former Vancouver Canucks on Team Canada that year.
On the 94 team?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Can you name 2 of them?
On the Canada team, 2 of them, former Canucks.
Yeah.
That's a great question. Okay. I need a little bit of time to ruminate. Were any of them drafted by the Canucks at this time?
Yes.
Oh, shit. Okay,
and they all were.
Really?
Three of 4 were.
3 of the 4 were drafted. Oh, my God. This is tough. 94? Okay, so they needed to have been drafted around, like, 92, 93, 94.
Yep.
Well, poop. Man, I'm probably going to blow this up, and Yerky's probably being like...
He's smashing his...
He is...
His transistor radio right now. Do you want any hints?
Yeah, get my brain stimulated here.
Well, the goaltender.
Oh, yeah, Corey Hirsch, sorry. Yeah.
Okay, now you mentioned a very specific time span of when they would have been drafted.
92, 93, 94.
Yeah, a little before that, maybe.
91.
This person was drafted in the first round by the Canucks. He has a name.
Right.
It sounds like it wouldn't be Canadian.
Oh, okay. Was he a bust?
No.
Oh, shit.
Stud.
Stud. Wouldn't be a Canadian. I know there's one, but I don't. He's not Canadian.
Who?
It's Nedved, but it's not.
He is. That's correct.
Okay. So, really?
Yeah.
Oh.
Because he is defected.
Defected? Okay, yeah. Sick. Great.
Do you want to know the other two?
Do you think I could get the other two if I tried? Or is it pretty hard?
The last one's really hard.
The third one isn't, though.
No, it's...
Give me a hint on the third one.
I think he was a defenseman.
Yeah.
Played on the... He played after the 94 team.
After the 94 team.
Part of a big trade.
Brian McCabe.
No.
Fuck. no, Brian... yeah. No, Brian McCabe was not... Oh, fuck. Big trade.
Rocky movie.
Well, who is it?
Who are the characters in the Rocky movies?
Rocky, Adrian, Gunner. No, what's his name? Apollo Creed.
Go back.
Second one.
The second one.
No, the second name you just said.
Adrian Acoin?
Yeah.
Nice. Okay, I love that. Okay, great, great, great.
And the last one, nobody will get because he was claimed off waivers, never played for the Canucks, Manny Legacy.
Did he? He didn't play for the Canucks?
No, he's claimed off waivers and then they...
He claimed off... No, he played... Oh, he did he?
Yeah, he never... wow, it was all weird there.
I thought he was in like training camp for the Canucks around the 2011...
Okay, next question. Huh. No, he... Okay, do you want what I have a question I think is the hardest one.
Okay.
You might not think so. Do you want it now or do you want it last?
Sure, throw it out.
Who's the current leading scorer on the Seattle Kraken?
The current leading scorer of the Seattle Kraken?
Points. Points leader.
Points? Do I multiple... Can I get two guesses?
Sure.
Okay. And I get one question. Okay, is it a defenseman?
No.
Great.
Glad we got that one out of the way.
Oh, I was like, how's the roster?
Is it a goalie?
Who is the leading scorer of the Seattle Kraken?
I told you it was a tough one.
I mean, I want to say Jared McCann, but I really haven't kept tabs on like Burakovsky, Bjorkstrand. I don't think it's not Bjorkstrand for sure. Matty Beniers. Who else would be like Brandon Tanev? Maybe I'm getting it too in my head.
Just name who you think who's the easiest.
Jared McCann.
Incorrect.
Okay. Brandon Tanev.
Incorrect.
Who is it?
Matty Beniers.
Oh, okay, Matty Beniers.
36 points.
All right, good for him. That's great.
Okay.
As you see, it hurts too much to see my rival down the I whatever the highway is.
I-5.
And Katie's just eyeing him up. And I'm like, if I'm not enough, I don't have enough cap space.
All right, there's two more. Do you want one that'll annoy you or a difficult one?
Either one. Throw it at me.
Two players wore number 66. Two players who wore number 66 both played for Laval Titan. Who were they?
Gino Odjick?
Yeah.
I knew it because I Googled a photo of Gino and he wore 66 for the Canucks.
For one game.
For one game. And it, okay. Is it Mario?
Yeah.
Okay, sick. Yes! Oh, okay, great.
And because of Mario, he went to 29, but it's for all the right reasons, as we learned
later.
Dude,
I just all class all the way.
Now we piss off Arash. I'm
putting the paper down, and I'm removing my glasses.
There are currently 12 teams in the NHL.
That have ever seen the color purple, both the movie and the color.
Without an alternate uniform.
Okay.
This does not include reverse retro because every team has a reverse retro.
So they
retro.
Don't have a third.
They don't have a third jersey.
Okay.
Name three of them.
Montreal?
That's one.
Yes. I knew it. Montreal's too arrogant to ever have it. Detroit?
That's two.
No, Boston has... Is it Boston?
That's incorrect.
Oh, fuck. Okay. Let me think. A third. Who would be way too arrogant to have a third jersey? Who doesn't need the money? No, it is true. What teams don't need the money? Kraken.
That's correct.
Yeah, Kraken don't have a third because this is their second year. Sick.
The 12 teams are Arizona.
Oh, really? They don't have a purple jersey?
No.
Nope.
They do. All of them are.
Lies.
Chicago.
Chicago-lucky.
Florida. Montreal.
Nice.
Nashville.
Smashville.
The Rangers.
The Rangers.
Ottawa.
Ottawa.
Seattle.
Seattle. Seattle.
Tampa Bay Lightning.
Nice.
And our hometown Vancouver Canucks.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they don't have a third yet.
No, we just have... The thing is, we have so many jerseys that we don't wear that are priced off as being so expensive. Well, Ryan, after today, how do you feel? Like, after the presser...
I feel great.
I feel like... I'm not saying, like, hey, hope is here and stuff, because I want to see what the moves are. I want to see what the plans are.
Yeah.
Like, show me, like...
The money.
Show me your moves. Like, whatever. Okay, can
you
I say...
You show me yours?
Can I...
I show you mine,
no?
Jim Rutherford.
Okay. That, no.
Plan for plan. What
no.
do you got?
No. I'm going to say the nerdiest thing that... Listen, if you've made it to this far into the podcast, I'm going to say the nerdiest thing I have ever said. And if you can understand the reference of what I'm about to say, send me a DM and I'll give you a pat on the back and we'll be extra special friends. But I'll tell Jim Rutherford, just as Falco and Fox and Super Smash Brothers said, show me your move. Or was it Captain Falcon that said that?
Good night, everybody.
Oh, no, Ryan, you gave me the sugar-free caffeine-free Coke. It's playing with my head. I don't know why. I'm a mess. All right, we're in a pickle here.